I cannot remember exactly when I first met Brother Tarbett. I think probably it was in Austin at the time he appeared on lectureship Brother Bill Jackson, the late Brother Bill Jackson, directed Southwest Congregation. But I also remember when he debated Billingsley on marriage, divorce, remarriage. In fact, we were involved in videotaping that at that time. But he has been a faithful gospel preacher for many years, 100 years. Now, Dub said that, but he's not far behind you. He was there as an old man when he started. Dub, why does everybody do that to you? I don't really follow that. Every time they make you getting off the ark or something like that. Nevertheless, we're grateful to have Brother Don Tarbett and his wife with us. I'm going to let him tell you where he's preaching and working now, but he's going to be dealing with matters that we probably won't get too many questions on, because he wanted to have this time to give more time really to that. He's got several books here. Now, these books, one of them, Jesus the Only Begotten Son, Tarbett Billingsley Debate, and Vision of the Two Jerusalems, a commentary on Revelation. He says if you will buy these, then he's got these other books. Now, you make sure I don't give away too much. That he will give you all three of them or one of them?
Whatever they need.
Well, I can't get more generous than that. So, anyway, if you buy these, he gives you these. And his table is back here. And one of these is Raving Wolves and Roaring Lions. Another is Boundary Safe and Secure. You have to figure that what that's about. And then With This Ring, A Biblical Study of Marriage, Divorce, Remarriage. So you buy one of these and you get these free. And so I'm looking forward to hearing what you got to say. Now, he said he wanted to say more on stuff. So when I said open forum, he could do it that way. He said, well, I don't want to take any questions. That'll take up too much time. I just want to be speaking on what I want to speak on. He said if there were a few questions or time at the end for questions, we'd try to get to that. So I guess the best thing to do is come up here and do whatever you're going to do. We'll go about 40 minutes.
Okay. Like
that, about 35, right. I'll come up.
Okay. It really doesn't matter what I do each Sunday, not during the week, but I'll tell you, I'm in my fifth year with the church in Atoka, preaching on Sundays and Sunday evenings, and Wednesday night I'm with the Martin Street Church in Denison, where Brother Jess Whitlock is now preaching, and I'm the song leader there with them on those occasions and teach classes and bring devotional lessons. Glad to be here. Been here several times before, and delight in the opportunity to be with you today. In keeping with the idea of errors regarding the Holy Spirit, I'd like to start with one relating to Luke 1 and verse 35. In reference to the promise of the Spirit that would overshadow the Virgin Mary, it says, and the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Several years ago, I heard Ralph Gilmore and Fred Hardiman refer to the idea that Jesus chose the Holy Spirit to be his Father. Reading recently from Roy Lanier Jr.'s commentary on the book of commentary on the epistles of John, he concurred with that the Holy Spirit is indeed the Father of Jesus. Well, that was strange to me to hear that. It says here in Luke 1:35 that the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. So the Holy Ghost would come upon her. And so it is concluded by some that means the Holy Spirit would be the Father of the one who would be born. But notice that it says the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Who is the highest? I read in Ephesians 4 and verse 6 that God, the one God, the Father, is over all and through all and in all. So he's the highest. And there are other passages in the scripture that indicate that. Someone gave Jesus all authority. You read 1 Corinthians 15, you'll find in verses 27 and 28 that it was the Father God the Father. Matthew 28:19 refers to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We normally think of the authority, the rank of authority in that regards. Now, in Luke 6 and verse 35, we have reference to the attitude that Christians are to have in regard to persecution. And it is said, "But love your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and ye shall be the children of the highest." Now you turn to Matthew's account, almost the same wording, except it says the children of the Father. So the Father, God in heaven, Jehovah God, is the highest. So he's the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ in regard to his physical body. Now if the Holy Spirit is the Father of Jesus, then he must have two fathers, one for himself and one for others. He often spoke of my Father and your Father, my God and your God, to disciples. And we know that he spoke to his Father in heaven, the Lord. And so if the Spirit was his Father, then he must have had two fathers. And we would also have two. And it might be that one would be the grandfather. You remember the old song about I'm my own grandpa? We keep fooling around with the scripture, we're going to come up with something like that. But we learn from the scripture that God sent the Holy Spirit. This is taught for us clearly in the book of John, in John the 14th chapter, and also in John chapter 16. But in John 14 and verse 16, it is said, "I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever." The Father is going to give the comforter. And then in verse 26, "The comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things." Then in chapter 15 and verse 26, it talks about the fact that the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father. Now, consistency would tell us that God must have sent the Spirit to overshadow Mary and to cause her to conceive and give birth to the one who would be called the Son of God. Now, contrary to the idea of some, we know that this is certainly contrary to the will of God. Now, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all have their roles to play. And the Spirit's role was involved in this regard, as well as receiving to us, giving to us the Word of God. Back about 1988, Hugo McCord, Ralph Gilmore presented some information at Fried Hardeman on a special day to try to prove that the Greek word monogenes means unique and not only begotten. And I've been concerned about this for a long time, and that's what brings me to the study in Luke chapter 1. And I was privileged to put out this book, Jesus, the Only Begotten Son. And sometime back, someone learned about that, young preacher in Alabama. And he wrote me a letter and asked me if this book had anything to do with what Brother Hugo McCord had written. I said, yes, it does. He asked me kindly and firmly, I'd better be quiet about it. He said, "Brotherhood's at peace now. We don't want to hear any more about that at all." Brother Todd Clifford was the one who wrote me that letter. But I have before me here something that was on the internet. I don't know exactly when it was written. It put on the internet, dated November 2005, about a year after Brother McCord passed away. And the article is entitled, Begotten and Unbegotten. Now here's what he admits on page 1. Physically, Jesus was begotten in Mary's womb by the Holy Spirit, Luke 1:35. Yet his whole concept to rearrange the scripture was to prove that Jesus was not the only begotten Son of God, but he was the unique Son of God. Now he admits that Jesus was physically begotten, and the only way we could learn that is from the scripture, which says he was, so why not admit that he was? Now, in this article, he proposes that there were three times Jesus was spiritually or figuratively begotten. Now, the only begotten has to do with birth, and yet he applies this to three things. And it's a quotation from Psalms 2 and verse 7. First of all, he said Jesus was physically or spiritually, figuratively begotten at the resurrection, then at the coronation as king, then at the ordination as the high priest. And these are three occasions. But if you study the scripture, it seems that the work of being a king and a high priest took place at the same time. But he has him thus figuratively begotten those three times. But these are not three separate begettals, and these do not have to do with those things. When it refers to Jesus, according to Psalms 2 and verse 7, "This day have I begotten thee," this is simply identifying the one who is going to be the king, one who is raised from the dead, and one who is going to be the high priest. So I ask, what does begotten, a pre-birth event, have to do with resurrection, coronation, and ordination, except to identify the one being involved here, who was raised, who was crowned, and was ordained? Brother Todd Clifford wrote me a letter and asked me to be quiet about this matter. And he said, "There isn't a single man on this list who believes in Jesus more than I do." Well, I believe that Jesus was the begotten Son of God, and he doesn't want to admit that. So maybe my faith is a little bit different than his. But after publishing the book, he kindly asked me to refrain from discussing the matter any further. I challenged him to a discussion on it. He said, "I would think that one who has had as much debate experience as Brother Tarbett would realize he has posed a false dilemma. The question is not, is Jesus the only begotten Son of God? The real question is Jesus only begotten the only possible rendering of John 3:16? Don has posed the question in such a way as to set one against the other, and not to support his stated position is to reject the deity of Jesus." Well, I asked him to reword the proposition if he felt like he should and could, and he would not do so. Now, I'd like to take time to make note of something in reference to the concept that the word "unique" to apply to the one who is called the only begotten Son of God is supposed to be just another way of translating monogenes, monogenes. So I went to my thesaurus, and in the back it gives some synonyms. And it would seem to me that if one thing means, if the only begotten means unique, that it ought to be a synonym. And I read the synonym for unique on page 239. It says, "Choice, distinctive, exceptional, matchless, peculiar, rare, singular, sole, solitary, uncommon, unequaled." That's it. The words "only begotten" not there. So it's not a synonym for "only begotten." And I know it can be translated that way because Hugo McCord did so, but that doesn't mean it is a correct translation. Here's something that Brother McCord wrote in reference to his work. "The phrase was not in the old Latin before the end of the second century, which used unicus, meaning only, alone of its kind, unique or singular. But Jerome, in his Latin Vulgate, 380 to 385, translation, changed unicus to unigenitus, only begotten. Jerome's translation became the Bible for Western Europe for 1,000 years. The King James, 1611, and the American Standard, 1901, copied Jerome's double renderings, as has the NASV, 1960. More recent translations, RSV, the NEB, and the NIV, have removed "only begotten." Furthermore, the translations, RSV and NIV, that omit the word "begotten" and say that Jesus is the only, one and only Son, or the only Son, for God has many sons. He points out that they're actually missing the point there, because we know that God did have other sons. Adam is called the Son of God, Luke 3 and verse 38, and we are sons of God today. But at least he wants to argue that Jerome is responsible for these things. I did some research on this matter, and I found the Apologist Bible Commentary, and It refers to these things that were referred to by Brother Hugo in years gone by. And it says that the external and internal evidence of the earliest manuscripts indicate that there was a discussion regarding monogenes. And according to the majority of scholars, that it existed primarily in the Alexandrian text types, and the Textus Receptus is involved. In the verses referred to in the New Testament as the only begotten Son of God, these six verses says Jerome renders it in Genitus, only begotten, and it continues to discuss the problem that they had. The discussion in those days seemed to be whether or not it was a noun or an adjective, and not so much as whether it belonged in the scripture. But there were various thoughts that they dealt with in these particular situations. And of course, I have all the information here in that particular commentary of the apologist. And the question is whether he's the only one, the only Son, or the only God, or the only one God. Now, they were trying to determine if the term referred to Christ as God or whether it referred to the Son of God as being begotten. Now, it was argued by Brother Hugo that the man Jerome is responsible for that. I did some research further, and I find a writing here from Irenaeus, who was born in 130 A.D. and died in 202 A.D. at the age of 72. And in his writings, or against heresies, he does say something about the only begotten. Here's what he said. No man hath seen God at any time except the only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. This is in Book 4, chapter 20, and verse 6. In other words, Irenaeus at least was aware of the concept that some believed Jesus was the only begotten Son of God. Tertullian, who was born in 155 and died in 240 A.D., likewise said something along this line. He says in Against Praxeas, chapter 7, his first begotten Son, because begotten before all things, Colossians 1:15, and his only begotten also, alone because begotten of God in a way peculiar to himself, from the womb of his own heart. So here we find Tertullian and Irenaeus and others, long before Jerome. So his premise is wrong in thinking that that's where it began, changing from the scripture. The Syriac Peshitta translation dates back to 125 A.D., one of the earliest arrangements of scriptures before some additional books were added to the canon. And in this particular study of the Syriac translation, it said the word itself is a feminine form meaning simple, easy to be understood. That's defining the word Peshitta. Seems to have been used to establish the versions. And the Syriac translation, the New Testament, began at Antioch, the capital of Syria, and it is said to be the first translation of the scriptures, the Christian scriptures. And we have a reference in the Syriac New Testament as early as 160 to 180 A.D. regarding these matters. And it says in the Syriac canon of the New Testament in the first century, and I have before me the arrangement of the Hebrew, the Aramaic, and the Greek, and the English. And the word monogenes is there. And it's translated, one begotten from the Father. So the idea that this began in the 5th century and should be abandoned is certainly contrary to what the early church knew and believed. In looking at the various translations of the word, some of the translations that we're familiar with and not familiar with, perhaps, that use the word begotten, such as the NASB, King James, Aramaic, King James 2000, ASV, Douay Rheims, Darby, ERV, Webster's, Young's Analytical, and so on. Now, some that do not have it, such as Holman, NIV, NLT, ESV, and NET. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this Holy Bible Modern Literal Version or not. But if you go on the internet, you can get one from some of the suppliers of books there. And I received my copy just about a week ago. I ordered it and was able to get it with postage paid for around $6. And it's well worth it. It's a literal, modern-day, literal translation of the Scripture. The word baptism isn't in it. It's immersion. And that's the way it is arranged, literally. In reference to John 1 and verse 14, it says, "And the Word became flesh and resided among us, and we saw His glory, glory like that of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Then in John chapter 3 and verse 16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His Son, the only begotten, in order that everyone who believes in Him might not perish but have everlasting life." In verse 18, "He who believes in Him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." So it's a good translation for you to consider and do work from in your studies. I do not have Brother McCord's translation. I've contacted others, and they do not have it either, but we know about it. And I contacted Dub McClish, and he sent me this information. I asked him how Brother McCord translated Acts 13:33, Hebrews 1, 5, and 6, and Hebrews 5, 5, which used the word begotten in reference to Christ, quoting from Psalms 2 and verse 7. And he tells me that Acts 13:33 reads this way, "You are my son, I have begotten you today." Now, if only begotten means unique, why didn't Brother McCord translate that unique? Hebrews 1, "You are my son, I have begotten you today." Hebrews 5, "You are my son, I have begotten you today." Now, there are a number of preachers in ages gone by. Reference has been made to this lectureship to some of the old pioneer preachers. Let me read you a list of some who believe that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. You'll recognize these last names: Campbell, Lord, Milligan, McGarvey, Lipscomb, Bowles, N.B. Hardiman, A.G. Freed, G.C. Brewer, Gus Nichols, B.C. Goodpasture, Thomas Warren, Roy Deaver, Alan Hires, Dub McClish, Garland Elkins, Curtis Gates, L.R. Wilson, H.A. Dixon, Foy E. Wallace, G.K. Wallace, George DeHoff, Rex Turner, Global Music, Wayne Jackson, Wendell Winkler, and V.E. Howard. Now, not all of these now believe that. Wayne Jackson has come down on that a little bit differently. And I contacted Brother Alan Hires and asked for his present conviction. He did not answer. But I have a quotation here from him from another source. He says, "I believe monogenēs is a compound word, the mono meaning one, or alone or only, and the genēs, the idea of begotten, is altogether a proper translation to say the only begotten of the Father. I think too much that we have relied upon able lexicographers through the years who give this as the meaning of the word. It is only when people have an axe to grind that they tend to find new definitions and new vocabulary that suits the positions that they have taken." We had a preacher come up to the Morton Street congregation in the last few years. He was a graduate of the School of Preaching in Colorado. And he kept referring in his sermons on Sunday nights when I'd be there to Jesus being the one and only Son of God. And I asked him why he was doing that. He let me know that he was trying to do away with the idea of his being the only begotten Son of God. And he had gotten his information, I'm sure, from someone in the school or perhaps his grandfather. His wife is the daughter, or granddaughter, of Wayne Jackson. That may give us a clue as to why he holds that view. Now in the Cambridge Bible, in reference to Hebrews 11:17 on Abraham's only begotten son, it reads this way, and I think these thoughts here will help us to understand maybe why that was worded. Ishmael is here disregarded as in Genesis 22:12 and 16. He's no longer considered one of the true family. That's from the Cambridge Bible. Pulpit commentary says, Hebrew unigenitum vulgate, meaning the only son of Sarah, the only legitimate offspring he possessed, the only heir of the promise, the only child that remained to him after Ishmael's departure. Benson says Isaac is so called because Abraham had no other son but Sarah, his legitimate wife. Jameson, Fawcett, Brown say Isaac was Abraham's only begotten son in respect of Isaac and the promise. Abraham is a type of the father now sparing his only begotten son to fulfill the divine purpose of love. Douay Rheims translation, take thine only begotten son, Isaac, whom you love. Wycliffe's Bible says, take thine only begotten son whom thou lovest. Now, even though Abraham had another son, Ishmael, he no longer possessed him. Do we think for a moment that God did not know that? In a sense, Abraham had two sons in all, but Ishmael had been cast out and was dead to him, as was the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. God specified that as far as, number one, Sarah, and number two, the promise were concerned, Isaac was the only begotten of Abraham through Sarah. Now, virtually every translation keeps within the text, whom thou lovest, identifying Isaac as the only begotten son of the passage. God then reminds Abraham that Isaac was the one through whom the promises made to him were to be fulfilled. Green's Greek-English Lexicon of the New Testament tells us that the word monogenes means only begotten. Berry's Greek-English New Testament lexicon says that it means only begotten. D.R. Dungan's Book of Hermeneutics states that rules by which the meaning of words shall be ascertained. Number one rule, all words are to be understood in their literal sense unless the evident meaning of the context forbids. And the rule applied here, the literal or most usual meaning of a word is, if consistent, should be preferred to a figurative or less usual signification. Now, read all that point out that Jesus was the only begotten of the Son of God in reference to a physical birth, a literal birth, and would not be a figurative situation. It's interesting to me that every time reference is made in John 1 and in John 3 and in 1 John 4, where you find the six times that the words only begotten are five times that are found in reference to Jesus, there's always in the context his physical birth and our spiritual birth as we being the sons of God. Begotten by the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God was involved in the birth of Jesus, and the Spirit of God is involved in our spiritual birth. Ours is a figurative birth today. Now that there is the context of these verses that demands a figurative interpretation of the word son. And it's also interesting to note that the Greek word for son is referring to a male offspring. And that's the word son that's used in John chapter 1 and verse 18 and 14. Now McCord says that Jesus was figuratively begotten three times, in the resurrection, in the coronation, and in the ordination. While there is never any idea of a figurative birth connected with any of them. And that's strange indeed. According to the decree, the Word was to become the Son of God. And from that sonship, he would become king and high priest. The two offices are always together in the scheme of redemption. Zechariah 6 and verse 12 declares that the branch, Jesus, was to sit and rule on his throne. When he became king, he was automatically ordained as our high priest in heaven. The two positions are always, from their beginning, simultaneous. His dominion given to him when he went before the Ancient of Days, Daniel 7, 13 and 14, began, and he has always been a priest on his throne as king. The Hebrew writer stated, we have such an high priest who is set at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, Hebrews 8 and verse 1. So when Jesus began his reign as king, he immediately and automatically began his role as high priest. One did not exist without the other. So the theory that Jesus was begotten twice in reference to these things, once as king and once as high priest, is simply untrue, did not occur in that manner. Gill's exposition of the entire Bible, Bible study tools, according to Google, there is found this statement. He was a son previous to his being prophet, priest, and king, and his office is not the foundation of his sonship, but his sonship is the foundation of his office. We concur with this without question. Vine says, the expression, "Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee," Psalms 2:7, quoted in Acts 13:33, Hebrews 1:5 and 5:5, refers to the birth of Jesus, not to his resurrection. In Acts 13:33, the verb raise up is used of the raising up of a person to occupy a special position in the nation. As of David in verse 22, so of Christ as a prophet in 3:22 and 7:37. The word again in the King James Version is in verse 33 represents nothing in the original. The RV rightly omits it. In verse 34, the statement as to the resurrection of Christ receives the greater stress in this respect through the emphatic contrast to that in verse 33 as to his being raised up in the nation, a stress imparted by the added words from the dead. Accordingly, verse 33 speaks of his incarnation, verse 34, of his resurrection. Perhaps you have learned of or heard of Thomas Aquinas. He had a commentary on the Gospels of St. John, as it's called. And on page 126 of that particular book, I find something of interest I'd like to share with you. Note that sometimes in Scripture we call Christ the only begotten as here and below, 1:18. It is in the only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father who has made him known. Excuse me. At other times we call him the firstborn. When he comes, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says that all the angels of God adore him, Hebrews 1:6. The reason for this is that just as it belongs to the whole blessed Trinity to be God, so it belongs to the Word of God to be God begotten. Sometimes, too, he is called God according to what he is in himself. And in this way, he alone is uniquely God by his own essence. It is in this way that we say there is but one God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one, Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. At times we even apply the name of deity to others, insofar as a certain likeness of this divinity is given to men. In this sense, we speak of many gods. Indeed, there are many gods and many lords, 1 Corinthians 8:5. Along these lines, if we consider what is proper to the Son as begotten, and consider the way in which this sonship is attributed to him, that is, through nature, we say that he is the only begotten of God, because since he alone is naturally begotten by the Father, the begotten of the Father is the only one. But if we consider the Son, insofar as sonship is conferred on others through a likeness to him, then there are many sons of God through participation. And because they are called sons of God by a likeness to him, he is called the firstborn of all. Those whom he foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he might be the firstborn of many brothers. I have here, or I had it with me, I don't know if I have it here or not right now. Yes, I do. After Brother Todd Clifford wrote me what he did, I answered him this way. Sorry you feel the way you do toward the matter. It is a matter of whether we believe that John wrote or we don't. Jesus was begotten as a beginning of his conception by means of the Holy Spirit, or he was not. Thank you. The effort is to change the meaning of the word into vagueness and just bury our heads in the sounds of complacency while all is quiet and let the next generation drift farther and farther away from the concept of the deity of Jesus. How would you feel about someone saying we should not concern ourselves as whether or not Jesus was born of a virgin? Just leave it alone and not disturb the water while all is quiet. Just be content with the position of denying the begetting of Jesus by the Spirit, and let the water run off the duck's back. May be the convenient and peaceful, but is it right? The Greek word monogenes simply does not mean unique or one and only. It is a combination of monon, which does mean only, and genes, which does refer to birth, just as beget in the scripture refers to the producing of offspring. I agree that Jesus was and is unique, but why? Was he unique because he was unique? Or was he unique because of how he was begotten in the womb of a virgin? How can you have him born to a virgin without having been begotten in the womb, without the aid of man? Whatever notes you may have on Hugo's position does not do anything more than camouflage the fact of the scripture. But if you are comfortable with it, I'll not disturb you anymore over it with my material. Hugo's material did contain errors about the original language of the Greek regarding monogenes, irregardless of what his notes have to say. Have a good week. That was part of my response to him. I think I have another portion here if I can get to it. Take about 3 minutes to read this. Let me do so, if you will. Todd, excuse the delay in getting back to you. I've had an issue with my email provider that has left some of my correspondence in limbo. Hopefully, things are now better. Wish I could say the same about our debate proceedings. You wrote back and spent almost a page telling me how you were just too busy to debate. All you wrote would take up about one half of the space of one affirmative or negative speech. There are several things about which now I make comment. You have stated that a few, if any, of my group could care less about what I'm saying. How do you know that? I might add that I have had a tremendous response by several in my group agreeing with me and are troubled about your indifference toward the matter. Even this date, I received a letter of support and have had phone calls of support. I find that a lot of brethren still do believe in the miraculous conception of Jesus to become the only begotten Son of God. Two, regarding the debate, I am wondering if it would be beneficial or would it involve me having to run down a lot of rabbit trails to spend precious space showing you have misrepresented what I wrote. There are several things you stated that are incorrect. A, you stated that I told you that the matter of Jesus being begotten is not an issue of eternal consequence. I searched my correspondence with you and I find no record of such a statement. What if it is a matter of eternal consequence? I certainly know it could be if it causes one person to lose faith in the deity of Jesus because he rejects the miraculous conception, first and later the virgin birth. Jesus was born of a virgin who was conceived of God in order to become the Son of God, and he was begotten of God for these things to take place. You state that the issue is not about Jesus being begotten in the manner stated above, but about translation. Surely our correspondence about translation is all right, for I believe unique is a wrong translation and only begotten to be a correct translation. I believe this because of the fact that Jesus was begotten of the Father. Do you believe that he was? Do you believe that he was not? I've searched your letters and do not find where you even agree that Jesus was begotten of the Father. I would like for you to tell me, was he or was he not begotten of the Father, so as to become the only begotten Son of God? You gladly say he was unique because Hugo said so, but I want to read your words that say he was the only begotten Son of God. If you do say so, tell me why you believe it. And if you do not believe he was, why not? Does the scripture teach that he was or was not the only begotten Son of God? Do the scriptures teach that Jesus was merely unique while not saying he was the only begotten Son of God? C, you state that no one believes in Jesus any more than you do. Well, I believe that he was begotten of the Father. Do you believe that part about him? If so, what passage or passages teach this? D, you stated Hugo just believed there was more than one way to translate monogenes. You're right, he did believe that, and he so translated it as unique in his New Testament. But was that a correct translation? I do not believe it was. Is only begotten a correct translation? Apparently, even you believe it is, because you argue that it can also be translated unique. Was not the Brotherhood satisfied with that translation before Hugo came along? Was not he the one that disturbed the peace rather than me being the one that is disturbing the peace today? E. You state that my assertion that to accept unique is not to believe in the deity of Jesus is a flat-out lie. Todd, that's pretty strong language. Where did I say you are denying the deity of Jesus? Do you deny that Jesus was begotten of the Father before being born of a virgin? You determine how close this might be toward denying the deity of Jesus. Do you know of anyone who denies the virgin birth who did not first deny the miraculous conception? You may say that you believe in the miraculous conception, and that is good. But what does such a conception suggest except as translated in the King James, New King James, ASV, and the NASV? Then third, regarding my questions, I would truly like to see your answers. If you can answer them, I guarantee you that I can show from your answer that you either do or do not believe that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God by the answers you give. I will be glad to reimburse you for postage expenses if you will print them out and send them to me. Will you take me up on my challenge? I'm thinking you have already observed that the consequences of your answers would be devastation. Let me show you. Then fourth, you suggested that my propositions are inaccurate and worded in such a way as to present a false dilemma. Well, if you don't like the way they are worded, you can reword them and we'll take it from there. I suspect you see that Todd would be in a dilemma by taking either affirmative or negative as I present them to you this way. How can it be corrected so as to not have a dilemma? I absolutely know that some in my group would like to see the matter discussed. What say you? When you write back, be sure to either say, I believe Jesus is the only begotten Son, or I do not believe Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. Tell us plainly. If you don't, I will assume you are already in a dilemma, as some were in the New Testament who refused to answer Jesus' question about the baptism of John, whether it was from heaven or of men. I predict you will not state either of the above when you write. We shall see. Time passes fast. Thank you very much for your interest today.
Brother Don, we thank you for bringing this material to us. When I first heard of this, and he ran some things in contending on this thing, and some of us had been exposed to Brother Todd Clifford some years ago on other matters, I couldn't figure out, and I have yet to figure out, I didn't understand when Brother McCord came out with his version and made the big to-do over only begotten and unique and all of that. I couldn't figure out why do that. How has it benefited anybody in their concept of Jesus Christ and who the Bible declares him to be to get into all of this, except that it's a poor translation? And I don't know of anybody that would come around and say, at least a great many people who are, all of us would consider to be scholars in the Greek, that would turn around and say that, well, that unique is a much better translation, gives us a far better understanding of Jesus. It's just more accurate. It's more in harmony with the Holy Spirit had in mind when he used monogenes. Why didn't people think of that 100 years ago or 200 years ago? How does it help anybody? Maybe somebody explain that to me. So it seems to me that Brother McCord and folks like him disturbed things when there was no reason to disturb it. I don't know how it's a better translation, trying to render into English, choosing a better word or words, what the Holy Spirit actually said and what he meant by monogenes. And I think that is well pointed out by Brother Tarbit. And he has his little book here, as one of them I mentioned earlier, Jesus, the Only Begotten Son. So we thank you for presenting that to us. And I hope it's been a good addition to the material that we have had or are having in this particular sorry to say debate, lectureship. We'll consider ourselves dismissed now and until tonight, a regular time period. So thank you for being here, and we are dismissed.